against any of them. If the priest that is anointed do sin, you remember that if it's always there, it's not when, it's not, you know, I can always do this, and you know, I don't have any power, this is my weakness, lying is my weakness, fornication is my peculiarity, adultery is my weakness. No, let's not talk about that. Those ones are candidates for hell. Those are firewood for hell. But this is accidental. If the priest that is anointed do sin according to the sin of the people, it says then let him bring for his sin which he has sinned a young bullock without blemish unto the Lord for a sin offering. He will not say, well, since that happened, it doesn't happen every time, and it just happened now surprisingly, accidentally, okay, God understands. No, he still bring an offering, the sin offering. He'll make atonement for that accidental sin. And that's what the Lord is saying. Look at verse 13, that same chapter. Look at verse 13. In verse 13 it says, and if the whole congregation of Israel sin, if the congregation is not sinning every time, the congregation is not, you know, that's the way we are, will always do that, and you know, God will have to accept our congregation just like that. It's a peculiar congregation, it's a peculiar situation. No, God doesn't accept that. He says, if it's an individual that sins accidentally, if it's a priest or the prophet or the preacher that sins accidentally, if it's a whole congregation, you know, sometimes there are some congregations out there, and you know, once you come in, everybody knows that congregation. They are good in this, they are good in this, they are good in that, but there's a peculiar thing they do. And once a new convert comes in there, you know, that thing will splash on them. It's like, you know, if it's adultery that is peculiar to that congregation, they don't repent, they don't turn away, they just keep on committing that adultery. They say, well, God knows we're good in every other thing, only this peculiarity. You know, sometimes there are some people now, they say they have youth church. And that's your church, they are all there, the adults are, you know, on their own, and then you just go there, their kind of music and their kind of lifestyle. And that youth church, there is a peculiarity there. Fornication is the order of the day. And people say, you know, that youth church is wonderful, it's beautiful, it's glorious. Only one but, only one situation, you know, fornication is rampant there. And the leaders know, and they leave them like that, because they say, you know, these are young people, we want them to be free. They are free to go to hell, they're free to perish. But you see, if a congregation sin, look at verse 13, if the whole congregation of Israel sin through ignorance, and the sin be hid from the eyes of the assembly, and they have done somewhat against any of the commandments of the Lord concerning the things which should not be done, and are guilty, when the sin which they have sinned against it is known, the congregation shall offer a young bullock for the sin and bring him before the tabernacle of the congregation. It's talking about the propitiation for their sin. It's talking about the atonement for their sin. It's talking about the blood that should be shed, even for that sin, even when it's the whole congregation that does something like that. Look at verse 27. In verse 27, here's what it says, and if any one of the common people sin through ignorance, any one of the common people sin through ignorance. You know, there are sometimes that somebody says, I'm born again, I'm a child of God, and then he goes to something that he shouldn't have done. I would say, come on here, this is wrong, this is not right. Oh, he says, pastor, hold on, I'm not, you know, I don't know Bible, I don't know English, I only know our vernacular Bible, and therefore I may do things, this one you are talking about, I may still do it again. That's a child of hell. But you know, it says, any one of the common people, if he does something, sinning against the Lord, read it yourself, verse 27, and if any one of the common people sin through ignorance, while he doeth somewhat against any of the commandment of the Lord, it says, concerning the things which not ought not to be done, and be guilty, or if a sin which he has sinned come to his knowledge, then he shall bring his offering, a kid of the goats, and a female without blemish for a sin which he has sinned. You will see then that, the Lord is not talking about the people that deliberately go into sin. You know that adultery is wrong, and they say, well, I just want to do it. You know, fornication is wrong. They say, even because they are talking about it, because they are hammering it, and they say, fornication, 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 let them do what they will do. I'm even going to do it because they are mentioning it. When they stop mentioning it, then I will stop. But because they emphasize it all the time, deliberately, I'm going to do it to show them that I don't accept what they are saying. You are showing us that you want to go to hell, you want to perish. Look at the Bible. Hebrews chapter 10. I'm reading from verse 26. For the people who deliberately go into evil. Some people say, I'm going to punish my husband. That man is not, doing well. He's not, he doesn't understand how to, pet your wife and talk to your wife and all. I will punish him. And I know he doesn't like this. I know nobody likes it. No husband likes it. I'm going to do it to make him angry and to make him suffer. You will go to hell. There are some husbands that will say, I'm going to punish that woman. I demanded for this and she didn't allow me to do what I ought to do. And then I'm going to punish her. I'm going to do this. You will go to hell because that's presumptuous sin. That's not, if any man sin by accident or by surprise, that one is deliberate. Look at Hebrews chapter 10. I'm reading here from verse 26. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 26. For if we sin willfully, after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins. If we sin willfully, they said that, somebody stole money, and then they disciplined the person. That's what you're going to do. Because of that discipline you laid on that person, I'm going to show you that I will do it. I didn't even think I was going to do this before. But because of what the church is saying, because of the direction the church is going, I am going to do it. And do whatever you want. You will not be forgiven. That's presumptuous sin. You want to go to hell, you open your eyes and you say, because they said this, because they said that, I am going to sin. You will lose your soul. You will go to hell. Look at that verse 26 again. It says, and if we sin willfully, after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sin, but is certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation which shall consume the adversary. He that despiseth Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. Of how much sorrow punishment, suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy who hath trodden under underfoot the Son of God, and has counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing, and has done despite unto the Spirit of grace. For we know him that has said, vengeance belongeth unto me, I will recompense, says the Lord. And again, the Lord shall judge his people. Verse 31, it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. And so you understand, we're not talking about those who deliberately go to commit sin and they say, I don't care what they say, I don't care what they preach, I don't care what they are teaching, this is what I'm going to do. We're not talking about those people, but those people that are surprised, with their careless, and accidentally something happened, and then they go to sin, and then they rush back into to Calvary. They rush back to the Lord and say, Lord, I'm sorry. It pains them in their hearts. They are sorrowful in their hearts, and they repent in bitter tears. Those are the people that the Lord will forgive. But the people that just deliberately go on in that rebellious, backsliding position, there's no provision for them. James chapter 5. When you come back like that, you need to understand you are coming back as a backslider. You are coming back as a sinner. In James chapter 5, verse 19, brethren, if any of you, can you see every time he's talking about sin, he's talking about Eve. It's not talking about when, you know, this is a natural thing, everybody will do it once in a while, and when you do it, no problem, no big deal, just go back to Calvary. Not at all. This is it. This is accidental. If any of you hear from the truth and one convert him, he was a believer, he heard from the truth, he backslid, he now needs conversion, he needs conversion, he needs restoration, he needs salvation, he needs a cleansing again, forgiveness again. Verse 19, brethren, if any of you do hear from the truth and one convert him, let him know that he which converteth the sinner, he was a believer, but now he's a sinner. He which converted the sinner from the error of his way shall save his soul from death. If he didn't repent, he will die in that sin, and he will go to a lost eternity. He'll go to hell. But because, you know, he knew he backslid, he's returned to the Lord. He says he'll save his soul from death and shall hide a multitude of sins. The Lord is calling us to righteousness. He's saying we should not sin. In fact, it says in Titus chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 11. It tells us in Titus chapter 2, verse 11, for the grace of God has appeared, that bringeth salvation has appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness. That's what the gospel teaches us. Deny ungodliness and worldly laws, shall live soberly, righteously, godly in this present world. That's what the gospel teaches us. That's what the Lord teaches us. And that's what all the preaching we're hearing, messages we're hearing, that's what they teach us. Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly laws, we should live soberly and righteously and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might... Tell me out loud. Redeem us from all iniquity. That's the purpose. To redeem us, to save us, to take us out, to rescue us out of all iniquity, and to purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. That's the reason he saved us. And that's the reason we are coming to the Bible study, so that you'll be strong in your Christian faith and strong in your Christian conviction. And you will know a Christian is not supposed to be falling and rising. Little children or young people or fathers, this thing I write unto you, that ye sin not. And if you have sinned before this time, today settle with God. And after you settle with God today, you will not go back to that sin again, in Jesus' name. We come to point number three now. The great propitiation and redemption without bounds. Without bounds, that means this redemption is for everyone. And this provision is for everyone. Salvation available for everyone. And cleansing available for everyone. Forgiveness available for everyone. Freedom from sin available for everyone. A ticket to heaven available for everyone. The experience of knowing the total redemption of the Lord and knowing the sanctification of the Lord, the sanctifying power and the purifying power available for everyone, so that you'll not say, well, this is maybe it's not for me. I'm not supposed to be saved and victorious. I'm not supposed to be saved and righteous. It's for everyone. Look at it now in chapter 2 verse 2, 1 John chapter 2 verse 2. And he is the propitiation for our sins. He's talking about the believers there now. Those who are falling to sin, come back again and go to Calvary and understand that he, Christ, is the propitiation for our sins. Then he says, not for ours only, not for those in the church only, but even for those in the world, not for ours only, but also for the sin of the whole world. There should be no doubt in your mind that Jesus Christ died for everyone. Jesus Christ gave his life for everyone. Look at 1 John chapter 4 verse 10. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 10. It says, herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins, to be the atonement for our sins, to be the sacrifice for our sins, to be the covering and the cleansing for our sins. Look at verse 14. And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world, the Savior of every sinner in the world. That's why it says, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you come, he will not reject you. Whosoever comes to me, I will in no wise cast away. That's why you can come. And as you come, the Lord will forgive, he will cleanse, he will save. And if you are already saved, he will make you steadfast and true and faithful in Jesus' name. In Romans chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 23. Romans chapter 3, we're looking at it from verse 23. In verse 23, it says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But what's the provision that he has made for everyone? In verse 24, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation. You see, that is a sacrifice. You see, that is the atonement. You see, that is the blood that is shed that makes us acceptable in the sight of the Lord. Propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission, removal, forgiveness of the sins that are past. Listen to that. Of the sins that are past. Of the sins that are past. Why am I emphasizing that? There are some erroneous teachers and false preachers. They will say, God has forgiven us. He has forgiven us the past, the present, and the future. That means you have a license, because, you know, whatever sin you commit in the future, everything is taken care of. Those are the people that want to habitually keep on sinning, and they want to excuse their sin, and they want to rubbish Calvary and rubbish the atonement of the Lord Jesus Christ. And they say, all our sins are forgiven, the sins of the past and of the present and of the future. It doesn't say that. It says is to give us remission of the sins that are past through the redemption of God, to declare. Verse 26, I say at this time is righteousness, that by that he might be just and justifier of him which believeth on the Lord Jesus Christ. As you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you understand that it becomes a propitiation for your sin. Anywhere you are in the world, whoever you are in the world. John chapter 1 verse 29. John chapter 1 verse 29, the next day, John sees Jesus coming unto him and says, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away, tell me, the sin of the world. The sin of the world, the whole world. He made that sacrifice for the whole world. Chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 16. Chapter 3 verse 16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, no matter where he's living, any part of the world. You know, there are people that say, well, if you are predestinated for salvation, if you are ordained for salvation, if God has marked you down from eternity, you'll be saved. There's nothing like that. He loves everybody, and Jesus Christ shed his blood for everyone. That's why it says for God so loved the whole world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Verse 17, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. The world, everyone in the world. In verse 20, verse 18, now you declare yourself if you're a believer. If you believe in that blood that is shed, that's how the salvation will be yours. Verse 18, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already. The one that separates himself, the one that says, no, I don't want the blood of Jesus to cleanse me, to provide forgiveness for me. I want to go to heaven by myself, and I'm going to try the best I can. No, you cannot try the best you can. Your best will be like filthy rags, and you will not be able to get there. And so if you reject this only way, this one way that leads to heaven, you'll be forever lost. Because it says, he that believeth not is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Look at chapter 4, verse 42. He's the Savior of the whole world. Savior of the whole world. He's not the Savior of just a section of the world. He's sacrificed for everyone. That's why it says in chapter 4 of John, verse 42, and said unto the woman, now we believe, not because of thy saying, for we have heard him ourselves, and know that this is indeed the Christ, the Savior of the world. Indeed, this is the Christ, the Savior of the world. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 18. He's telling us that he wants to reconcile the whole world unto himself, and all things of God, who was reconciled to himself by Jesus Christ. He has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation, to which, that is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself. Reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and has committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we as ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled unto God. That salvation is available for everyone. And because of the atonement, the ransom was made for everyone. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, I'm reading from verses 3 and 4. 1 Timothy chapter 2, and we're looking at verse 3. 1 Timothy chapter 2, and we're looking at it from verse 3. Here is the word of the Lord talking about the redemption of Christ for everyone, the salvation of Christ for everyone, the atonement of the Lord Jesus Christ, the death he died on the cross for everyone. In 1 Timothy chapter 2 verse 3, for this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved. That's his desire. That's his provision. Who will have all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. He doesn't want anybody to perish, and I pray you will not perish. As you turn away from sin and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, salvation comes. And God is no respecter of persons. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Look at 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but he is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish. Not willing that any should perish. You'll be reading some erroneous materials, and he's saying that God has ordained and predestined and predestinated some to perish forever and ever. They don't even have a chance to repent. That's wrong. That's wrong. He says he's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. I pray that if you have not come to repentance, this will be your day. And you will come to repentance in Jesus' name. Because he has tasted death for you. He has paid your penalty. And you can come to the Lord. Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2. I'm reading here from verse 9. It says, for we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should tell me what follows. Tell me everything in that sentence. Say it out aloud. Won't you go? Taste death for every man. He died for you. He died for everyone. He died for the whole world. Jesus Christ died that you might live. He gave his life that you might come to the cross and come to the Father. He wants to bring you to glory. He wants to bring you to salvation. He wants to bring you to redemption. He wants everyone to repent. The times of ignorance he winked at, and now he commands all men everywhere to repent and to turn to the Lord. And if you have not turned to the Lord, this is your chance. Nobody knows when you will leave this world. Nobody knows when you will die. And nobody knows when Christ will come. If you delay another day and you are not saved, you might be lost and spend eternity in hellfire. But understand that Jesus Christ died for you. He tasted death for everyone. Then it says in verse 10, for it became him for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory. In bringing many sons unto glory. He wants to get you ascension to heaven to make the captain of our salvation perfect through sufferings. For both he that sanctifieth and they which are sanctified are all of one, and for which cause is not ashamed to call them brethren. You can come in today and become a brother, a sister in Christ. You can come in today and become a little child in Christ. You can come in today and become a new convert in Christ. You can come in today and then you come into the kingdom, and then your sins are wiped away. Forgiveness has come, redemption has come, and then you'll be able to live in righteousness by the grace of God, by the strength of the Lord, for the rest of your life. You understand, the purpose of the study today is to remind you that if you are in Christ, if you have come to the Lord, you should live a righteous life. Members, live a righteous life. Ministers, live a righteous life. Pastors and preachers, live a righteous life. Men and women, live a righteous life. My little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Salvation is available. Sanctification is available. Freedom is available. Forgiveness is available. Righteousness is available. Purity of heart is available. Holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord, is available. Come today. He will forgive. He will set you free. He will cleanse you. He will purify you. He will purge your soul, your spirit. He will give you the strength and the power and the grace to go and sin no more. New strength, new life, new ability will come into you, and you'll be able to say, praise the Lord, I've learned this so that I sin not, and the grace of God will keep me and I will not sin. Am I talking to somebody there? You will not sin in Jesus' name. Rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer and say, Lord, have mercy on me. Lord, have mercy on me. I want to live a righteous life. I want to live a pure life. And I thank you for what you've done for me. You've made the sacrifice for me. And I know that you'll purify me, you'll purge me, and you will so cleanse me and give me the grace and the strength and the power that I will go and sin no more. Go and sin no more. Go and sin no more. These things have written unto you that she may not sin. These things have written unto you that she may not sin. These things have written unto you that she may not sin. If you have sinned in the past, make up your mind now by his grace, in his strength, through his salvation. You'll live a righteous life. Pray and pray through before you go. That temptation should not keep on overcoming you. That evil thing should not keep on overcoming you. You should overcome. You should overcome. You'll be more than a conqueror. Temptation will come. You say, I will stand. And those trials will come. I will stand. No, you will not do evil. You will not continue in evil. You'll say, Lord, cleanse me, wash me, purge me, purify me, make me holy, make me righteous. He will do it. He will do it. Salvation is so precious and salvation is so great that that salvation will keep you away from sin. And then you keep on studying the word of God so that you live the righteous life. The word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Awake to righteousness and sin not. Almighty God, we thank you for the Bible study tonight. Thank you because
in Jesus' name we pray. Our mighty Father, we thank you, Lord, because of the message. Father, I always call upon you. Let us be the doer of the word and not the hearer only. You deliberately preserve today for certain purpose, and later I say it. I pray that every one of us, we are going to be touched by the word in the name of Jesus Christ. Hell is so hot. And then, Lord, we have had the privilege of listening to you many times. If I thought the judgment will come, or angry, attitude, on our way of life, on our dressing, on attending to God adequately, I don't want to misuse God. We will be the first. Because almost every, now we are getting to more than 87,000 people. And then it always starts from us here. I pray by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, this world will not stand against the kingdom of God. And your grace will be sufficient for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Let us sit. Let us be seated. Before I let us go today, I will let this thing be on the workers' day. But because of important part of it, and then one day I was speaking to the RO, and then he asked me, this thing, did you address it immediately in the open church? I said, yes. He said, that's good. He said, because the open correction is better than secret correction. And then I decided to do this because God deliberately made today happen. We are not more than this. And then all what is happening now, you will see if a stranger is here, he will believe we are not organized. He will totally believe that we are not organized. It's not my work. It's not the work of my wife. It's not the work of that Stephen. It is the work of every one of us. We lack some things that I want us to understand. The children for this age, in every church, they have their department. Then they provide everything they need according to their age. They provide it there that attract them. So somebody from the age of 0 to maybe 1, 2, they have their class and they provide toys. And 3, 2 to 3, or they have their class, they will provide something attractive, maybe like exercise thing or jump. You get what I'm saying? Then for 5 to, they provide another thing because they have experience of that thing, and they providing everything that we attract them. Our church have not grown to that, but we are getting there in Jesus' name. I'm saying this because when the more than 5,000 people were following Jesus Christ, that he said the hard things, then many of them go back, remain 12. But the hard thing he said was very hard. That he too know that I've said more than enough for these people. He now asked them, do you want to go away too? Peter answered, where will we go? Because we know you have the word of life. So I can say it to every one of us here that by the grace of the Lord, I have confidence in you that you not say because Pastor Matthew said this or but because of what is happening, we are not coming to church again. Because I know you are looking at how we are going to build this church and for the glorification of God, not for the glorification of anybody. So when we have the kind of attitude the children play today, I want us to be very, very paying attention. It's not a matter of it is my work, it is your work. It is a matter of what can we do to make the service better. In this kind of situation, we are the first person to be taking note of ourselves. We come to hear the word of the Lord. And we must go with the word of the Lord. Anything that will disturb us, we try all what you can do to minimize it. And that's why if you take note of me, because we are using this basement as a family church, I only want to make sure of something. My own family, we are not in that room at the same time. I only want you to take notes. If my wife is there, I will never be there. If I'm there, I will do everything possible for my wife to come out. The reason is this. If the whole enlarged of family go and stay there, then only my family will be on the seat. And that's when we organize the service for ourselves. And what applies to a lab of family applies to me because it's the church of the Lord. It's not my church. So I want you to take note when I'm doing some things strange, not that it's strange. I'm looking beyond that the church is under our roof. That's first thing, which I want you to take note. Another thing is this. When children behave like this, that's why I said we need to be praying ahead. Pastor, pray only one message. If I do not get anything today, there's one message again. And I was not even here, I was inside. That because your husband do this, and you say you are going to punish your wife. Said, we are not going to say anything. You are playing with her. Because your wife do this, and you are saying you are going to do this to your wife. He said, you are not going to say anything. You are playing with hell. If I don't get anything in that message, I get that one. So, if children act in that way, it's better one person stay with the children and the remaining people, they hear the word of the Lord. You know, only two out of 12 is better than a child disturbing the whole 12. And that's what I do to make sure I and the girl, if at all we are not going to listen, it will be only me and the child. And if it's going to be only the mother of the child, it will not be that the child is disturbing the whole church on that day. If it is a counselor or that's going, we are know that today you want to show a bit of a child, if it is only brother Steven is going to stay with him till he could down, he cannot behave the way my wife is behaving. You see, I came with me, we started training him to get to this level, and you see him now. I'm not saying me because of him, we have fought before you come. But we started training to able to get to this level that he can open the Bible, he can jot down. It's not a day business. But this how now they are coming up. This how we need to train every one of them. So all these things I want us to take note. Just because of one person, just because of one is Carlos, not just because of one, just because we want to make sure the purpose of coming to the church is not being defeated. And God is going to continue to help us in Jesus' name. And the grace of the Lord will continue to help us. This, because I say it, all these kind of things has caused problems within us. The reason is this. They will say, see their children. They are the ones that even disturb me the church. What's my purpose of coming to the church? Okay, we are accused. Okay, let's move out of this place. If you know that we should be coming to the Lord, let's move out of this church. Okay, provision of moving out of the church. Can anybody provide it? We are ready to move out. Then nobody will surrender to provide it. But they will be accusing our children, or they will be accusing us. But what we surrender, everything we you see, my wife, I don't go to work on Monday. She doesn't go to work on Monday. I don't go to work on Wednesday. I don't go to work on Sunday. Just because of this church. Okay, we have sacrificed this. Anybody that want to suggest, as we are running to the kingdom of God, I know every one of us, we know that we are not serving Pastor Matthew, we are serving God. All of us, we are running to get there. So if we believe that the rest just for Pastor Matthew is not enough, although I will do everything I can do, like if I don't explain all what happened today, you will not know. But I will do everything. But then not everybody you can explain to. Not everybody here have the demand of listening. But I know I've dealt with all of you, and I know the side. I know what you can do. I know that's why I'm able to come out. That when things happen like this, let us do it in this way. Let us do it in this way. And God is going to help us in Jesus' name. I'm planning to preach about love. I'm planning to preach about let it go. And all these things will come in by preaching by the grace of the Lord. You know, there are some things I will do. I'm not exaggerating. I know your situation, but I know how you love me. There are some things I will do. He will never take note of it as a negative thing, no matter what the case may be. I've tested him. I know how he talks. I know. I've no respect. He has rent. He has render. He may not know that I'm taking notes. He will not because of anything, because of the love of Christ, because of the respect he's given to Jesus and then he's given to me. But some of those things, if I do it to somebody like not him, they will say he's too proud. They will say, is he not a human being? They will even say, who give him this, who give him that? So I know the condition, the reason why I said this, and I know by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, every one of you will continue to pray for the church. God bring a lot of things like this so that when the church become large, we will know how to undo it. And we will know how to manipulate everything for the goodness of the Lord. And God is going to help us in Jesus' name. Let us pray. Almighty Father, we thank you, Lord, we glorify your name for all what you have done. We pray for the message you have preached to us again. You are the one that called us, and we have surrendered all. And you have told us, on this rock, you are going to build the church. Father, let your will be done in Jesus' name. And let your name be continued to be respected. Thank you, Lord, because you are the Lord that answered prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. The service is over.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.